Good morning, everyone. I am delighted to welcome you here today. I'm Katie Culver, director of the School of Journalism, not the School of Journalism, the Center for Journalism Ethics. I start out with an untruth. What a way to begin the conference. Thank you so much for being with us. You know, it's always interesting to try to pick a conference topic. We do it in about May, June, and you never know quite what's going to be percolating. But I was speaking with one of our advisory board members, and I said, I think this thing really has legs. It's going to go beyond the election, and I think it's going to stay a current topic. I had no idea that it was only going to intensify over time. So we have a lot of wonderful content coming at you today. I'm deeply, deeply grateful to all of our speakers, panelists, our moderators. They're going to do so much for us today. And so I'm not going to give you many remarks at all because I'm going to leave the time for them. I do want to offer some thanks, though. First and foremost, to our sponsors who make today possible and made free registration possible. One of our big goals this year was to increase student attendance at the conference and to increase attendance by members of the public, people who weren't necessarily in newsrooms. And we did that, and I'm very proud of that. So let me thank the Gannett Foundation, and we have representatives from Gannett here. I'm so grateful to you. The EVU Foundation, which is the charitable arm of the Capital Times. The Ethics and Excellence in Journalism Foundation. WPS Charitable Foundation, the Wisconsin State Journal, PDL Digital and producer Phil Levin, Wisconsin Watch, the Wisconsin Center for Investigative Journalism, and the Wisconsin Broadcasters Association. So if you could please all give them a round of applause for supporting this important work. I'd also like to thank my colleagues in the School of Journalism and Mass Communication. From the time the Ethics Center was founded, they've been really committed across the board to the mission of the center and supporting its work. So especially the actual director of the School of Journalism and Mass Communication, Hemet Shah, who has been a champion of this work. I'm deeply, deeply grateful to them. Also, a huge thanks to Rowan Kalix, who I hope is watching on the live stream. He works in the Journalism School's main office, and he is the brains behind all of the travel details of getting people here. Very happy there wasn't weather this year that shaved years off of his life. We have three student fellows who support the work of the center, Cadence Bambanek, Olivia Bruce, and Ben Pickman. They've been a really energetic and great team to work with this year. My colleague Lindsay Palmer there. Lindsay Palmer is an affiliated faculty member with the center. She does terrific work, especially on ethics and journalism in areas of crisis and conflict. She's just been a terrific writer for the Center of Journalism Ethics website. I recommend going and reading her work. She's got great style. And then I've been saying this week that my brain is mush. It's been living outside my body, and its name is Mallory Perryman. Mallory is the project assistant. Where is Mallory? She's the project assistant that supports all of the work of the center. And this conference would have been absolutely impossible without her. She's a friend, and she's a force. I'd also like to ask the members of the advisory board for the Center of Journalism Ethics to stand, please. There are many of them here. That applause is incredibly well earned. Some people sit on boards because they just want to have their name associated with something. That is not this group of people. They are active, they are engaged, they are truth tellers. They are very, very important to me in telling me when things are going right, but more importantly, when things are going wrong. It's been a really active year for the Center for Journalism Ethics, and I couldn't be more grateful for their support. I would like to give a special nod to one person, and that is Jim Burgess. Jim began us on this track to where we are today. He's the one who put the coal in the engine that has been driving this train known as the Center for Journalism Ethics. It was his idea years ago, and I'm grateful to him for setting all of this in motion and hope that today, as we work our way through this program, he will be as proud as I am of the lineup that we have. So with that, I would like to invite our keynote speaker up to the stage, Margaret Sullivan. So Margaret, when I contacted Margaret through one of our board members, Margaret had a great idea. She said, I'm not interested in speechifying about this. I would like to have a conversation. So that's what we're going to do today. We're going to have a conversation. I'm going to move over and join Margaret. There we
Okay.
And we're not going to do all that much talking because we want to hear from you as well. So when I think about Margaret, I think about reading pieces that are the thoughts in my head coming out through Margaret's keyboard, but only with a lot more fluid writing than I'm capable of. So Margaret, as I think all of you know, is media columnist for The Washington Post, and she came there following a stint as public editor at The New York Times. She also had a distinguished career at the Buffalo News, working her way from summer intern all the way up to its chief editor. And she gained a lot of accolades for her work there. So all the students in the room, I want you to, I'm just going to repeat that. She made her way from summer intern to chief editor. All the things our career advisor tells you are indeed possible. So I'd like to start out, well, actually, I want to say one thing about your bio. Everybody can read the bio in the program. But I have always found Margaret to be an incredible champion for a free and responsible press, which is what we're here to talk about today. And she just recently received an award that I'm a little jealous of. A little jelly, from the New England First Amendment Coalition for her long-standing support of First Amendment rights throughout her career, and I think it's even doubling down today. So congratulations.
Thank you very
on that
much.
Front. Okay. So let's get going.
Okay.
All right. So just before Inauguration Day, you penned a piece. It had quite a splashy headline, a hellscape of, I know you don't write your own headlines, but a hellscape of lies and distortion is what was awaiting the news media in this new administration. And in it you wrote, I'm going to quote you, "We can expect President Trump to lie to the media, manipulate reality, and go after those upset with the notion that adulation is his birthright." Again, see that beautiful writing. I could never say it that well. So I'd like to take us back in time a little bit, march backwards from Inauguration Day. What did you see from the news media throughout the coverage of the campaign? You know, there was a lot that happened to get us where we are today, mm-hmm. to get to that hellscape headline. So what was your evaluation and what were some of the ethics involved?
Well, just a word, hello everyone. First of all, hi. It's great to be here. I love Madison. This is my first trip to Madison. I'm like, it's a great town.
Yay!
Yeah, I mean, it's wonderful. What I saw during the campaign was something that was shocking, really. I think we've become kind of a little bit inured to it now, but we had a candidate who was, you know, very forcefully attacking the media. And, you know, at his rallies and in his speeches, he was identifying the news media and journalists as, you know, scum, the lowest form of humanity, and then ultimately the lowest form of life. And so there was this incredible, aggressive attack on journalists. And it was, I think, you know, people will say, oh, you know, there have been many politicians in the past who've set themselves up against the press. And that there is truth to that. But I don't think we've seen anything anywhere near this level. And it's pretty startling. I mean, during the campaign, he was also talking about changing the libel laws, which is not so easy to do, of course. But just the fact that there would be discussion of that. In fact, I believe he tweeted even today about changing the libel laws, so he's still talking about that. Many of Trump's supporters took this on, I think, and you know the press began to be really under attack. So that was what led me largely. It was looking back at the campaign and looking forward into the presidency that made me feel like there might be this so-called hellscape. It is funny, just a little bit of an aside. We have some really terrific people at the Post who specialize in writing headlines. And I'm not talking about copy editors who write headlines for print. I'm talking about digital people who are very skilled at writing headlines, as I think there's a little thing that goes around every week. Moments of digital greatness, and these are headlines that you know do express what the story's saying, but also express them in a way that's going to get some interest. And that headline about the hellscape of lies and distortions was one that did generate a lot of interest, and maybe it was a little overstated, but it did kind of do its job.
So what are some examples of journalists or journalism that you think were problematic throughout the campaign? Mm-hmm. What were some of the things we did that we should not have done? And then flip that coin. What are some of the right. Moments that you admire?
And there are plenty to choose from in both. I mean, I think the biggest problem I saw, and the thing that I faulted the news media the most about during the campaign, was the way the cable networks, you know, and CNN, certainly Fox, but certainly CNN, gave Trump incredible free exposure. I mean, there would be moments where just the podium would, you know, waiting for him to arrive. And the New York Times did a calculation that he had received some $2 billion worth of essentially free advertising. And you know, you can track this back if you look at CNN. I did a column about this. You know, Jeff Zucker is the president of CNN International. He had also been at NBC when The Apprentice was happening. He understood very well in both of those corporations that Donald Trump was indeed what he calls himself, which is a ratings machine. You know, he generates interest, he generates ratings, ratings generate profit. And, you know, the head of CBS, Les Moonves, also said Donald Trump may not be good for the country. This was during the campaign. He may not be good for the country, but he sure is good for us, meaning our bottom line. So I think the emphasis on ratings and on what will generate the most money through ratings was, and kind of an abandonment of, if not an abandonment, you know, less interest than there should have been on balancing that with the public interest. So that would be the major fault. I do think there was some great journalism that happened during the campaign. I mean, I have to point to my employer, the Washington Post, as perhaps foremost there. David Farenthold did some incredible work about Trump's charitable giving or lack thereof, and the way he sourced it, the transparency of it, the way he used Twitter was really showing us how to do investigative journalism about politics in a new way. And the Post also managed to write a full book about Trump called Trump Revealed during the campaign and publish it. I mean, it's a serious, real book that was well reviewed. And so I don't think you could say that as a country, we didn't know, you know, who was being elected. And, you know, you might say, well, what about Hillary Clinton? And Clinton, I think, because she had this long career as a senator, as Secretary of State, as First Lady, we were very, very, as a country, we were very familiar with, you know, she had been vetted and scrubbed so many times that there was less to tell people that was going to be new about her. But I think we did that too. You know, now that we have the benefit of hindsight, you know, we can talk about whether the news media, the mainstream media, engaged in false equivalency with Clinton and Trump. You know, were there all these things coming out about Trump all the time that were shocking? And was there a sense that, well, we need to even that out, so do we need to pay even more attention to the email, as people like to say as shorthand, but her emails, you know? Did we elevate that as a problem beyond what it should have been to kind of make it seem like we were being fair? And I think that's a real issue and a real problem.
So I was a big fan of Farenthold's work, and especially where it came from. So, you know, I think he was in Iowa and had really very little knowledge of charitable tax law, but thought, wait, that doesn't seem right, and continued to follow it. But my question is, Did that matter? Did that reporting matter? That story played very prominently in the Washington Post, and I know that it was circulated in some circles, but did it have an effect on public opinion about Trump and ultimately voting behavior?
Well, I mean, I don't think we should ask that question about our journalism. We can ask, does it matter? But I don't know that we should say, well, it didn't matter because Donald Trump is president now. We shouldn't be in the business of electing someone or not electing someone, I don't think. We do the work and try to get it circulated as well as we can and make sure it's right. And then the voters who are informed by it take it from there. And it may well be that, and I think it's true, that many of Trump's supporters, you know, he said himself, I could go out into Fifth Avenue and I think, you know, I don't want to misquote the president, but it was something like I can go out into the middle of Fifth Avenue and fire a gun or shoot something and it wouldn't matter to my core. And, you know, I think as we kept seeing one shocking thing after another happened, there was some truth to that. Many of those who voted for him, you know, weren't voting for him because of, you know, his biography or his history, but, you know, what it meant to them and their lives and the fact that they didn't like Hillary Clinton as a candidate.
It's interesting that you say that because media ethicists got really busy after November 8th. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We're in business for quite some time.
Yes.
And one of the things as I spoke with reporters that seemed to really bother people in newsrooms was that a lot of the critique of the ethics of campaign coverage, I mean, some of it was good about what you've identified with CNN, for instance, or the Les Moonves comment, but there was definitely this undertone or this undercurrent that you must have messed up because how did you let this happen to us? That the news media should have not let this happen. And I think a lot of reporters that I spoke with were very troubled by that because they said, look, we'll take all the critique you can offer, but we're not supposed to have a dog in this fight. We were not supposed to save you from Donald Trump. We report, you get to vote.
I mean, I think that if journalists hadn't adequately told the country who the candidates were, then I think they would have been at fault. But I think they did. And to the best, you know, they didn't have the benefit, for example, of Donald Trump's tax returns, or not much of them. Suzanne Craig from the New York Times did pick up her mail that one day and managed to get some of it. But, you know, I think that to the extent people wanted to vote based on someone's background, everything we knew about them, I think it was out there.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Are there things that we should be doing differently now? You know, are there some fights that we have a dog in as news media? Are there things that we should be advocating for?
Yes, I have come to believe that we have to advocate, not in news stories, let's say, but in general, journalists better take on the issues of maintaining a free and independent press, because if we don't, I don't know who will. And we really must get behind that, you know, whether it's organizations or, you know, groups of journalists or editorial pages or in other forms, we really need to be paying media columnists, we really need to be paying attention to that issue, because it's extremely important. You know, the Fourth Estate is a pillar of our democracy. It can't be allowed to be weakened. And I'm not sure that we're gonna see a lot of support for it if we don't do it ourselves. And I think we also have to get that message across to the public as best we can.
Mm-hmm. So I've been on a campaign against the term fake news. There was a time
too.
I told my students I would fine them a quarter if they used it in my presence, in part because I don't think it's specific enough. I think that journalism should be about specificity, but also because it came to be weaponized,
exactly.
to be used as a way to take down something that we didn't, we weren't comfortable with, whether we're a candidate or a leader, whatever. But so let's be specific, and let's talk about hoaxes and conspiracy theories and things that competed with actual reported news stories for audience attention and, right. and social sharing. What kind of effect do you think those hoaxes and conspiracy theories had?
I mean, I think they had a big effect. The stories that were being shared on social media, you know, the one that comes to mind immediately is the one that was shared over a million times that said that Pope Francis had endorsed Donald Trump. You know, and was it shared because people thought it was funny or because they believed it or, you know, some combination of the two? I don't really know. But there's no question that stories like that were being circulated. They were helping, they were keeping people from being well informed. They were, there was, I think, you know, while we saw them on both the left and the right, there was, I think, a concentration of them on the right. And we know that there were, you know, teenagers in Macedonia who were making money from setting up fake news sites in which they were just generating this outrageous stuff. And most of it was indeed, I mean, the ones that they were doing were pro-Trump. So, you know, I think it did have an effect. I mean, it's very, very hard to quantify. And now we also know that some of this stuff was being amplified by bots. So it was more than just you and me sharing these things. It was that they were, you know, being sent out into the universe in an automated way that is, you know, still happening, and it's very, very difficult to fight back against that. And I think the only way we do fight back against it is through informing, is through sort of, you know, news literacy and basic civics, in which people, you know, kids come to understand that they have to think about what they're sharing and try to understand that not everything that looks like a news story is one, and that a URL that says ABC News may not be the big network, but may be some fake news site. So, and I agree with you, even though I'm using this term because it's convenient. I do think that the words fake news are almost useless now, because they have come to be used for anything that anyone doesn't like. And the president is using it, and it, you know, it doesn't mean this is a lie in the form of a news story that was generated. You know, it's really just sort of like, I don't like that and I'm opposed to it, so I'm gonna call it fake news. And it's a way of, it's actually a way of undermining the truth, because if anything you don't like, factual or not, can be called fake, you know, how does the truth survive that? It really makes things very tough.
How worried are you and your colleagues about that survival of truth, about a public that isn't trusting news media the way that it did, and news media are facing this unprecedented competition with things like hoaxes and conspiracy theories and cat videos?
Yeah, that's right. I'm both very concerned and a little bit hopeful. I mean, the concern, I think the reason for the concern is obvious. You just said it very well. But the reason for hope is that I do know that legitimate, you know, some of the best news organizations have seen incredibly strong support from the public. The Post, the Times, ProPublica, a lot of the nonprofits are getting, you know, subscriptions, donations, support, from people who say, we need you, you know, we need to know what's going on, please keep doing your job. So I hear that a lot. And then I also, I mean, my email is the most frightening thing in the world. I get a lot of, well, this part isn't frightening, people saying just that, like, you know, thanks to you and others at the Post for telling us what's going on. And then just some absolutely vicious and vile kinds of things, and sexist kinds of things that, you know, it's very difficult, because I've always felt so thrilled to be a journalist. I've always felt like it was such a noble thing to do, and you know, something that I was very proud of. And to have a good portion of the country sort of hating you and thinking that your whole role is is something to be legitimately criticized is really tough to take. Not that we shouldn't criticize ourselves and not that we can't be criticized or that we do everything right, but the idea that we're, you know, evil and wrong and fake is that's something new and something that's pretty tough to take. You really, and I think for student journalists, you have to realize that you're coming out into a world in which a lot of people will be set up in opposition to you, and that just is part of reality now. You have to understand that there's a mission attached to our job, and we need to do it well, and you know, put on our big boy and big girl pants, and not get too worried about being under attack, because it's going to continue.
So last night I was at the Wisconsin Watchdog Awards. It's the Wisconsin Center for Investigative Journalism, the local chapter of the Society of Professional Journalists, and our Freedom of Information Coalition Council. Fact check that. Mm-hmm. And every year when I go to that event, I just bubble with pride at the work that's being done in Wisconsin, local journalism.
Yes.
And last night, someone wrote down a quote from a speech that someone said, "Everyday news is what everyday people look for." Mm-hmm. And when I look at things like the healthcare debate and saw the coverage that was going on in local newspapers about how this bill would affect Wausau, Wisconsin, mm-hmm. it was a really important part of
yes.
that information landscape. We spend a lot of time talking about the Times and the Post, and mm-hmm. you all are great, mm-hmm. But that Wausau paper is very, very important. It's shrinking, literally, mm-hmm. And figuratively. What do you think about when you think about the future of local journalism?
This is probably the thing that I'm most worried about, more than whether the libel laws will change or anything like that. I'm extremely concerned about the future of local journalism. I mean, I essentially spent my career in local journalism as a reporter and as an editor, and I know how important that reporting is to the community. You know, the idea that, you know, at the Buffalo News, we not only had an investigative team, but we had a medical reporter, we had a religion reporter, we had a, you know, an environmental reporter. Those are people who became real experts and were able to, and, you know, and what's more, an Albany reporter in the state capitol and a Washington reporter telling us what was going on that had to do with our community. If you lose that, you know, that is irreplaceable. And the business model, you know, so the purpose and the mission is hugely important. The business model is not there anymore, and it's getting worse all the time. It's still based on print advertising. And the digital advertising that or subscriptions that we thought would come along and hoped would come along and replace that haven't done so. And, you know, my paper was, in Buffalo, was and still is owned by Warren Buffett. And I've, you know, I have a friendly relationship with him, and I've talked with him, and now he owns many papers, and he's a newspaper buff. And, you know, he's not bullish on the future of newspapers. Now, that's not the only kind of local journalism there is. TV stations do important work. Digital-only nonprofits are doing good work. And I understand all that. But, you know, there was a time in about 2009 when I read this blog post, this sort of this seminal blog post by Clay Shirky, this NYU professor and sort of tech and the sort of the intersection of tech and journalism, big thinker. And, you know, he said in this, I think the name of it, you know, some of you are familiar with it, I can tell because you're nodding, but it's called something like Newspapers and Thinking the Unthinkable. And, you know, 2009, now it's a long time ago. But he basically said, it isn't newspapers that matter, it's journalism that matters. And I read that and I thought, that's absolutely right. You know, it doesn't matter what form they're in, we don't have to turn the pages, it's the journalism that matters. And I, you know, I think that kind of turned me into a digital true believer. And I still am, and you have to be. But I have also come to believe that the specific role of the local newspaper and the fact that you get it in this form and you turn the pages is important. And I think when we see that going away, it is a very bad loss. And I'm very concerned about the future. And I'm also concerned, while I'm on my high horse about this, I'm also concerned about the career paths of young journalists who used to be able to sort of say, you know, well, I'm going to be a reporter in Binghamton, New York, and then I'm going to, you know, I'm going to go to Buffalo, and maybe I'll stay there, or maybe, you know, I'll go to the Boston Globe or something, or maybe I'll stay in Buffalo and climb the ladder and become an editor or something like that. That career path, you know, is dwindling. And that worries me a lot, too. I mean, I want to advise young people to go into journalism, and I do so with a certain amount of trepidation because I think there's tremendous work to do, tremendously important work, but I cannot say with any certainty that you'll be able to have a nice, solid, steady, stable career with health benefits and, you know, a decent salary for the next 30 years or something. I mean, that would not be the case, I don't think.
So I have a little bit of a different take on that when I talk with students. And I have to say, if you want to be optimistic about the future of journalism, talk to a 20-year-old who really cares about journalism. Mm-hmm. You know, I rode my dinosaur to this very journalism school when I was 20, and I did what you said, you know, mm-hmm. Kankakee, newspaper, Milwaukee, then Sentinel. That's how old I am, pre-merger. And that was the career path of that time. I see them on different career paths now. Mm-hmm. So yes, that path may be made harder, but you know, they care about, we have a kid in the room, he's not a kid anymore, who really cares about international journalism, and he's forging his way. Is it easy? No. But does he have opportunities to do journalism differently than I did back then? Yeah. I think right. The digital world has opened up some doors for
well,
them.
Well, I agree
so
with
So don't
that.
Get nervous,
no,
kids.
No, no. And I mean, I also would like to say that I have two young journalists in my life who are doing great. One is my daughter's college roommate from NYU. She just graduated a couple years ago. And she's in New York, and she works for Gizmodo, which is part of the Gawker Media Group. And, you know, they've been purchased by Univision. And, you know, she's doing great. And that's, I have no doubt that, you know, she's making a good living. Great, that's New York. My nephew, who went to Grinnell, is working for The Hill newspaper and digital site, covering Capitol Hill in Washington, and he's the medical reporter at age, you know, 24, 25, and he's doing great. But let's remember, these jobs are in New York City and Washington, and, you know, the concern I have is in regional journalism and local communities, because we can't have all of our journalism taking place in New York and Washington and Los Angeles. We really, really need the journalism that takes place in communities. And, you know, I'm not so sure about that.
Okay, we're going to turn in just a minute to audience questions, but I'm dying to ask, you know, I'm a true believer that culture eats strategy every time. So I'd like to ask about your role as the public editor at the Times, mm-hmm. and how that ombudsperson fits within the newsroom culture. What kinds of impact do you think you had, or didn't have? Mm-hmm. You know, what worked, what didn't?
Right. So as most of you know, because it's a very journalistically astute audience, you know, the public editor at the New York Times is an interchangeable term with ombudsman, or in my case, ombudswoman. The Times has had this position for more than a decade, and it came about after the Jason Blair scandal, the fabrication scandal that really hurt the Times' reputation. And so the role of the public editor is to be the reader's advocate and to sort of be the outward-facing standards keeper for the paper. And it's a job with a lot of inherent tension in it, because you're in the newsroom and you seem to be sitting among your journalistic colleagues, but your actual role is to hold them accountable to the readers. And so it's very tricky, and it's not comfortable for 1 second. And it's, you know, I found it to be both really stimulating and growth producing for me. After I'd been in Buffalo for many years, it was great to be in New York City, and it was certainly, you know, fascinating to be at the Times. When I came, Jill Abramson was the editor, so I was there when, you know, she was editor, and then I was there when she got fired. The readers of the New York Times are very involved and very, you know, they want their paper to be what they want it to be, so you hear from them a lot. We would get, typically, I had one helper, we would get 500 emails a week, and sometimes a lot more. So there was plenty to choose from, you know, whether it was about the paper's coverage of the Middle East, whether in the early part of the campaign, whether the Times was giving Bernie Sanders his due, you know, all these kinds of questions would come up. And I just tried to be really fair, but to take things on as they came. And, you know, it was difficult. There were a lot of very uncomfortable days at the office. If I wrote I wrote on a blog and I wrote a column. And if I wrote a tough post that was critical, and of course I always included the Times' point of view, but then I would draw my own conclusions. And there were a lot of days when I walked in and I just felt like, this is not a comfortable situation at all. And, you know, but I think it's a great tribute to the New York Times that they do have that position, and I think that it can be of great service to readers. Okay. I mean, the one thing, I'll just say one other thing. The one thing I really pushed for was that the Times would hold itself to its own written standards on anonymous sources. The standards were written, you know, in the Times style book, and its ethics code. And, you know, one of the lines about it was that anonymity should be given only as a last resort, which sounded about right. And then, you know, you'd pick up the paper and every other story would have an anonymous quote or an anonymous source, and the front page would be all full of anonymous Washington sources. And so this was something that I pushed hard when I was there, and I was pleased. I mean, they never said this is because of the public editor, but I was pleased that shortly before I left, there was a real tightening up of the guidelines on anonymous sources. So I did feel that as a little bit of vindication, I guess.
I had a dear friend, the now late Steve Buttrey, who adored you for that. he railed on anonymous sources. Mm-hmm. So I'd like to open it up now to questions. We have students who will come to you with a microphone, because while we may hear you in the room, we need all the people who are watching our live stream to be able to hear you as well. So I see there's a hand here. So if you could just wait for the microphone.
I demand questions from women.
So right there in the middle, there you go.
And I like questions from men as well.
You alluded to this a moment ago. Would you assess the coverage of the Sanders campaign?
Well, you know, by whom? The media. I mean, it's very difficult to talk. I should have said this earlier. I will answer your question. It's very hard to talk about the media because, you know, what are we talking about? Are we talking about Breitbart, the New York Times, you know, ABC News, the National Enquirer? You know, who knows? It's so broad. But if we want to talk about the traditional press, I guess, the mainstream press, and how they covered Sanders. And I did take, you know, I can certainly speak to it at the Times because I wrote about it several times. There's no question that the Times wrote many stories about Bernie Sanders. You know, they covered his rallies, they covered what he was saying. I found that certainly he was getting, you know, before the conventions, you know, far less coverage than Hillary Clinton. And I did find that the tone of it was, it didn't take, it was at times somewhat, it didn't take him very seriously. There was an edge to the tone of it that I wrote about that I thought was unfortunate. It didn't take his ideas and the substance as seriously as I thought it should have been. Now, the editors at the Times disagreed with that and gave me 150 examples of how they did it right. But the numbers and I thought that the tone suggested that they didn't take it as seriously as they should have.
She's coming. Cadence is coming.
I was wondering if you could give us a sense of the mindset right now at the Post. Is there a sense of, we're entering another golden age, we're going to do Watergate all over again, and if so, how do you guard against predetermined outcomes? We're going to take down another president.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, great question. I don't think I do not pick up that attitude at all in the Post, let's go get them kind of thing. I don't see that at all. I think there is a sense that we're up against a big challenge. There's a lot to report on. We want to do it thoroughly and right, but I do not pick up the idea that give us enough time and we're going to take down. It's not about that. It's about doing the work. And Marty Baron, my boss, the executive editor of the Post, you know him from his role in Spotlight. Has said we're not at war with the administration, we're at work. And that's probably the best way to describe the atmosphere, which is a very, revved up, dedicated, there's a lot to report on, but not with a purpose in mind, other than doing the journalism right.
One back there, and then the following one up here.
Can you talk about transparency and the importance or effect of the lack of the press pool and how Trump is pulling this curtain down and not letting the press know what the heck is going on, especially like on foreign trips?
Well, that is one of the things that is very concerning. Is, for example, and I think probably the most glaring example of this was when Secretary of State Rex Tillerson went on his first big foreign trip. He didn't have the press with him. He had one reporter with him, but she wasn't there as a pool reporter to be the proxy for the rest of the press. She was there to write a profile of him. And, I wrote about this, actually, that she also, had written a pretty nice story about him, and so was that, at least you could ask the question, was this some sort of reward for that? And that's one example of many. I mean, the Trump administration is not playing by the usual rules, and that is something that I think Trump supporters are just fine with. They don't think that the elite media needs to be accommodated in that way. And that worries me because I know that the press does play an important role as the eyes and ears of the public. Not everybody in the public understands that or thinks it's important. But yes, I mean, the questions about what's happening in the briefing room with the so-called Skype seats, some of which are going to very partisan media organizations. There are some very concerning issues there, and that's part of what I was sort of looking at, and I don't see that going away.
Can I ask a follow-up to that? And that is, you said Donald Trump is not playing by the traditional rules. Does that mean that the news media need to change the rules that they play by? Or, do we have a mismatch between a media savant, someone who knows how to play those rules to his advantage, and the principles that we hold dear?
Well, I do think we have to do our job somewhat differently. We can't just say, well, we're going to just do it the way we always have. It's not possible anymore. So I think we have to be more transparent. We have to do our jobs we have to not only do the reporting, but sort of understand that we're in this era of a lot of disinformation. We have to, one of my colleagues is here, part of the great Washington Post fact-checker team, and that kind of thing has become more and more important and has to be integrated into everything we do. So no, we, you know, we can't act like it's 10 years ago either. And so things have changed. And, you know, it's very early. We're only, amazingly, only 10 weeks into this administration. That may be the most astonishing thing of all.
You talked about having to advocate to maintain a free and independent press. What to you does that, how do you get that message across, and what does that look like to you when there is such distrust for journalism mm-hmm. in the media currently?
Yeah, and the one thing, you know, I'm often asked, and I am concerned about the level of trust in the news media, which is, as everyone knows, at historic low point. And there is a little bit of, I just provide a little bit of context on that, which is that institutions generally, there is less trust in institutions generally, not just the press. And if you ask people, I mean, the Pew Research Group has done some really interesting research on this. If you ask people, do you trust the news media, they tend to say no. If you ask them, do you trust your news source? Now, that might be a local newspaper. It might be, you know, the CBS Evening News. Then the level of trust goes up a great deal. So I think that's important context here. I mean, the way we advocate for ourselves, you know, can take many forms. And it can take the form of, as I said, it can take the form of written work, like a column or an editorial. It can take the form of advocacy by media, you know, organizations or consortia. And, you know, there's a lot of things we can do.
It's relatively easy to report tweets and what Flynn is saying or not saying along those lines. But what I'm wondering about is the set of stories that's expanding right now. For example, the privacy that we've lost through the recent legislation, the net neutrality that's going to be tackled next, more complex stories that take longer to present, and journalists aren't covering them with the same fervor. I mean, everyone wants to be Woodward and Bernstein and all that and get the next movie made about them, and ignoring the more the climate-related stories, the other things that will have lasting impact for the future. Thank you.
Well, I actually think those stories are being reported. I know that the Post is reporting them and playing them on the homepage and on the front page every day. You know, is the public as interested in net neutrality as they are in whether you know, Putin is, you know, has some interesting information about Donald Trump? No, you know, but we still have to report it, and I think we are. Now, if you did an analysis of you know, what's playing big on cable news, then I think you're absolutely right. But this has always been the case, and I think one of the other faults of the campaign coverage was the lack of emphasis on the substantial issues that would affect the country, and the emphasis on the horse race. I mean, it was way, way out of whack. But this is nothing new. And it's hard to battle, because you are actually speaking to what people want. And, you know, you have to give them both what they want and what they ought to have.
I was wondering, can you give us a glimpse into the Post's coverage of the Russian influence on the election currently? You know, do you have investigative teams set up, the development of sources, where information's coming from? I'm kind of curious as to just how the newsroom is set up to cover that story and where the information is coming from, because it seems like there are times where we get articles that come out, and then it goes a while before we hear things, and it seems like the Post and the New York Times have done a good job of gathering that information and verifying it before they come out with their articles, whereas in the past we would see things coming like rapid. So I'm just kind of curious about if you can give us a glimpse into the newsroom of how it's being, how you're working that story.
Well, I mean, I should preface this by saying that I'm really not intimately familiar with how you know, I'm not a part of that team, and I'm not in the power structure at the Post. So I'm kind of observing it. You know, I'm at least a step removed. But I would say that a great deal of the best reporting, and the Post and the Times, as you know, are, you know, neck and neck on this coverage. Well, I actually think the Post is out ahead, but is coming from the reporters who have deep sources. You know, this is not like, oh, let's grab a bunch of investigative reporters out of nowhere and put them on this story. It's tending to come out of the beats, you know, some of the people who have been covering, you know, national security, the intelligence community, you know, the White House for many years, and it's coming out of deep sources that have been worked for years. So, and again, I think while the Post is focused on that story and certainly interested in breaking new ground with it, I also think there's a fair amount of very healthy skepticism about what really is there, and no sense that, you know, we're driving towards a conclusion that we are convinced is there. So.
Hi, I apologize for not being a woman, but I hope so.
I like men too.
Thank you. You mentioned a couple of times, Margaret, that it's important to inform the public. How does this strong watchdog reporting from news organizations like the New York Times, Washington Post, USA Today, where I work, reach the people who are getting their news from Breitbart, watching Fox, who may not be diehard Trump supporters, but are still people who voted or supported Trump? How do you reach them? How do you persuade them? It seems to me that's the current challenge that the strong reporting has.
Well, I agree completely. You've gotten to the nub of a really important problem, which is, and the Columbia Journalism Review just published a very interesting piece in which they looked at people who are reading things like, it's sort of, they called it the sort of Breitbart-centered media ecosystem. The people who are reading and getting their news from Fox, Breitbart, and other organizations like that are far less likely. There's nothing that sort of leads them over. There's no connective tissue over to more mainstream, more balanced coverage. Whereas those in the center and on the left read and consume news in a more varied way, so they're more likely to get a variety of news. So there's a sort of a sequestering, and once you're sequestered in that echo chamber, there's not much of a way to influence. And I mean, of course, if I were to write that or say that in a column, I would be told by many people in the most critical possible way that, in fact, it's the mainstream media that speaks all with one voice, you know. But I know, you know, and it's been backed up in studies that there is now this sort of group of news sources that are pretty far right and that are, you know, gathering a group of people around them who really don't want to hear too much of what you're talking about, the sort of the watchdog journalism that we think is so great. It may not be penetrating. And I don't know what the answer to that is, but I think it's a big question.
We have one here. We got a lot of questions.
At the Wisconsin Newspaper Association convention a month ago in Madison, it was the weekend when CNN was excluded and a few other sources were excluded at a press conference. And we didn't know all the details at the time, but we had a brief discussion of that there. And there was sort of a dichotomy of view, which was, you know, I know media is competitive against each other to be first and whatever. And so some people said, well, when certain media was excluded, then media that was there should have left in solidarity, that I'm not going to get a story that you're not able to sit here next to me and get. That was one view. The other view was, well, if you leave, then this, you lose the moment. No one gets the story. The public doesn't get the story. Can you comment on that?
Yeah, I mean, I'm I think, somewhat torn on it. There are situations in which I think we have to back each other up and put the competitiveness aside. And there could be an extreme situation where people should, you know, walk away from a news conference. I also think we need to be thinking about getting the story out and not getting on our high horse about something that actually is a way of shooting the citizens in the foot, you know. So, you know, there's no one clear answer to it, but I do think that we're going to have to be more cooperative and more supportive of each other, and at times be willing to lay aside our competitiveness. So I'd kind of veer more toward that.
The Washington Post is now owned by Jeff Bezos, who also owns Amazon.com. And I'm wondering if you, working at the Washington Post, are concerned about maintaining a distance and a wall, much as there used to be what we would call the wall between advertising and editorial, between Jeff Bezos and his ownership of the Post and control of the Post, and ownership and control of Amazon.com, and the impact he could have on Post reporting.
Okay, well, I haven't seen any of that, and I think there is a very strong firewall between the ownership and the editorial product. I mean, Marty Baron has said that he has editorial independence, and I believe he does, you know. So I don't think that, you know, and I can speak from my own experience reporting or having Warren Buffett as the chairman of the Buffalo News. I mean, there was, and I was the head of the editorial board as well, there was never a moment where he picked up the phone and said, you know, I want you to support, make sure we've got an editorial on Hillary Clinton, or anything like that. I mean, there really is, at respectable news organizations, a division and a separation between editorial and business, and it needs to be that way. And although it can be very hard for members of the general public to believe this, it does exist. And the Post has editorialized about tax policy in a way that I'm sure Jeff Bezos wouldn't appreciate, but it nevertheless does it. So I think that wall exists. I mean, I do think that Bezos has affected the Post in the sense that we've become very digitally focused and, you know, on the technology side of things, I think that his influence is felt, but on the editorial side of things, no. So I think there's a real wall there.
You mentioned that you thought the press had facilitated Trump's election to some degree by giving him all this free airtime. Do you think that's happening with his communicating through Twitter also? I mean, he's got his millions of followers, but the press, by multiplying that, makes it unnecessary for him to communicate through longer forms like press conferences. Do you think the multiplying effect of the Twitter thing is bad?
Well, you know, we've never seen anything like this before, and it is very strange. But I think that we have to cover what the president says in whatever form he says it, and we cannot ignore his tweets. And so while it does create the effect that you're talking about, I don't think we have a lot of choice. We can't say, well, he's going to have to talk to us in a press briefing, or else we're not going to cover him. I mean, he's using Twitter as a way to make some pretty strong statements. I think the way to handle it, and this is happening, is to fact check and question what he's saying in those tweets. I mean, when he, for example, very famously just a couple of weeks ago, accused former President Obama of having wiretapped him, certainly, that's a heck of a claim, and you have to report it, but at the same time, it led to some pretty deep reporting around it, and I think that's probably the key, is to, yes, report what he says, even if it means amplifying this sort of direct way to go to voters. And by the way, you know, I think we have to remember here that this isn't really working all that well for him. You know, that the president's approval rating is at a very low point. And so while he is getting his message out through tweets, you know, you also were covering what he's doing and the actions. And, you know, I think you have to do both.
We have time for one last question here.
What do you think about the narrative that has emerged since the election that for some time national media has largely ignored rural, white, working class Americans? Do you think that that's a legitimate argument? And if so, are there conversations that are being had at the Post about how to address that?
I think in general, the traditional press, the mainstream media, you know, it's false to say we didn't do any of that. We absolutely did. There were many stories, and there were great stories that were done from the heartland, you know, in the states that really mattered. Did we do enough of it? Probably not. Did we do it in as deep a way? You know, was it a little bit too much of visiting and writing the story as opposed to being immersed in the community and really getting a deeper understanding? So I think you can certainly, that is a legitimate criticism during the campaign. There's no question now that news organizations are doing a much better job. You know, I think that's a lesson that's been learned. And I think certainly, you know, the Post has something called the America Desk, in which they're spreading out throughout the country to do stories that really matter to people, you know, who aren't on the coasts. And I've seen it at other news organizations as well. I think there's a real effort now to be listening better to the voters and the citizens in a deeper and a more consistent way. So, you know, we were definitely caught by surprise on election night. And, you know, is that the fault of the polls? Is it the fault of weighing data journalism against shoe leather journalism? I mean, it's a complex answer, but I do think we need to be listening better and getting out into all parts of the country. And I see that happening.
Well, I know that we could go on for a whole nother hour, but the good news is this is not the end of this discussion. It's the end of Margaret's discussion, but we're going to dig into a lot of these questions throughout the day, benefiting from social science, from advocates, from working journalists. So, Margaret, thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you very much. Great questions.
And with that, I would like to invite up the moderator and panelists for our next session. So, Jason Shepherd, we pass the ball to you.